Welcome back to another episode of The Badge and Beyond, Inside the World of LVMPD. I'm your host, Joe Bartels. We had a great conversation recently with three officers from our recruiting section, and they shared with us what it's like to work for this department and what they're truly passionate about and why they got into this profession to begin with. Here's our conversation with our LVMPD recruiting section. Well, we have a full house today with our podcast. We have three special guests from recruiting. Guys, I would just want to start off by basically just to introduce yourself to the audience and then basically describe what it is that you do, essentially. So, Dave, since you're the most senior, I think, with recruiting, why don't you go first?
Yeah, so I'm Officer Dave DeLeon. Been on the department now for almost 19 years. So I've been in the recruiting section for about 7 years now. And that's my full-time job now is just going out recruiting, different recruiting events and, PT tests and just being out there in the community trying to recruit new officers and new employees to the department.
And you've been doing it for a while. What do you like about the recruiting section particularly? Because otherwise you could go on like we've talked about in previous episodes where this department is so great that you could do literally anything. You could be pushing a black and white, you could be flying a helicopter, you could be doing anything in between. So what about the recruiting section that you like so much?
Well, I think it's just the people that I get to work with as far as on the department and the people that are actually applying. The people that I get to deal with, especially on this side of it now, is deal with good people that want to join the department that love the police. So I think that's what's kept me here in recruiting. So that's why I've been here for so long.
Yeah, nice. Alfredo, introduce yourself and tell us what you do over at the recruiting section.
All right. I'm Officer Alfredo Lara Marquez. I've been on the department for about 9 years. I'm also a full-time recruiter now. Prior to this, just worked Northeast mainly. But I'm Vegas native. Just like being here, and it's nice seeing the people that are coming here. You know, people that want to apply actually want to be here, so it's nice. Plus, my coworkers are pretty great.
Nice, and you come from a military background?
Right, yeah. Prior to this, I was in Air Force, active duty. Switched to Air National Guard, so now I do Air National Guard and this.
Oh, very nice. Awesome. Jimison, introduce yourself.
I'm Officer Chris Jimison. I am the only corrections officer in the recruiting section. I'm a Vegas native, went to UNLV, had no plans of ever becoming a corrections officer, was just looking for a way to finish paying my way through school. And a recruiter talked me into corrections and is the best move I ever made. I've got to do a lot of cool things, do a lot of interesting things people would never expect a corrections officer gets to do, including being in the recruiting section. So I've been in the recruiting section full time now, a year and a half, and I handle the majority of the people who are interested in corrections, answer questions. I do jail tours so people can come into our facility and see what it's like to work in our jails, which are much cleaner and safer than most people think. And it's just a great time getting to meet people who are interested and have a passion for law enforcement.
I also hear that you were kind of the idea behind Do-Si-Do with Metro. How is that and how'd that come about?
Yes. Well, we were trying to come up with some different ideas, things to do. We do a lot of different like workouts with gyms in the community. And I had recently attended a line dancing event and realized it was quite a workout that I wasn't expecting. And it was pretty fun. And the country music was a good time. So I brought it up to our supervisor if it would be something that'd be possible. And he liked the idea. So we were able to partner with Stoney's. We had a great time. We had a good turnout there and I had a lot of fun. Hopefully we can do it again.
Yeah, definitely. A lot of people on social media were reaching out and they thought it was a great idea. And what an out of the box way of thinking of how you would connect with a cop, because we hear so much of the coffee with a cop and those kinds of things that traditionally law enforcement agencies do. This was so out of the ordinary. And I guess it was really well received, right?
Yeah, it was cool because, like you said, it's just something completely different. And it was a workout, but in a fun way. It was a good way for people to loosen up and come talk to people in the department so they can learn more about what we have to offer and truly get to see how officers and our civilian staff are as people outside the uniform. So I think the people that came out had a great time interacting. I know I had a great time interacting with the people who showed up. And, you can't go wrong with Dan. dancing and music.
Right, exactly. And Sheriff McMahill is always talking about how we need to inject humanity into everything that we do. And that also extends to recruiting as well. And we saw you in kind of an unusual uniform with the hat and the flannel and the boots and things like that. So it's all about trying to humanize the badge, I think, in some respects as well for that, right?
Right. And yeah, it's definitely fun when you get to, you know, change your costume once in a while, throw on some boots and a hat and just go out there and be yourself. I mean, I think some people might believe like law enforcement officers are like robots or like they're these tough people, which you have to be tough to a point. But I mean, we're normal people. I'm goofy. I like to sing, dance, have fun. And that's just what I want people to see.
Yeah, definitely. I heard Fox 5 had the highest ratings ever when you saw when they saw you kind of demonstrating on live TV your moves. So I want to get into a little bit of business here before we go any further down that rabbit hole. The process for recruiting is probably a lengthy one. I know when I got hired on the police department 3 years ago, I maybe wasn't expecting how rigorous and how in-depth it goes for maybe the whole background process. So I know it's a huge kind of description here, but Dave, maybe can you walk us through initially, how does one start the process if they want to become, say, a police officer? How does that process even begin?
So for that, you would just want to go start off on our website, mm-hmm. protectthecity.com. That's where you're going to see all the open positions that we have. And if you're going to go for like police or corrections, you know, we have the resources on that webpage. That's where you're going to apply. There's a study guide on there also. But we do monthly testing for those positions. You are going to apply, basically. That's the first thing that you're going to do. And then from there, you have to do a written and fitness test. Once you pass the written and fitness test, you're going to move on to the background process. And that encompasses like background interview, a polygraph, psychological written test, and then you also have to see a psych doctor. Everything is going to be looked at in your background, places that you lived, places you worked, your schooling, you know, and sometimes even the background detectives go out and talk to your neighbors to see, you know, what kind of neighbor you are. They go out to your job sometimes to see, you know, talk to your managers, your bosses. So it's pretty intensive. It can take anywhere. I tell people it takes anywhere from 4 to 6 months from when you initially pass a written and fitness test before you get into an academy. So it's nothing that happens real quick, but it is a lot faster process than it was before. When I hired on, it took me 11 months to get on. So, you know, the process is pretty intensive. So it's something that, you know, that you got to be prepared for also. So, you know, that's basically what the background process is in a nutshell.
Yeah. And Alfredo, I'm sure you've gotten some questions. I know when I'm over in recruiting, that phone is constantly ringing and there's constantly people asking questions. What are some common questions maybe that you've heard since you've been up there that maybe you can kind of help illuminate our audience about the process and getting hired on?
Well, the main questions we get is, can I still apply with DUIs? Can I get, can I hire on with certain medical disabilities or... veterans want to start the process, but they don't know quite when to start because of their military enlistment and how far their contract goes. As far as like DUIs and that, it's all case by case basis. You know, some are just straight up no-goes. But
you don't make that determination. It goes through a background detective and then they do their investigations. So they look at different jurisdictions and different, all sorts of different things. So you're right. So it doesn't matter. DUI could be other crimes too, right?
Right, right. So I can't say that to automatically, you know, disqualify her, right. But, yeah, like other questions we get, you know, like psych evals, that goes further along. Don't count yourself out immediately just because you see something regarding psychs. And then military, well, we can always defer for military, right? So if you can make it through the process while you're still in the military, if you're ready to go to an academy, but you're not quite done with your enlistment contract, we can defer you. We can wait for you so you have a career waiting for you when you get out. And that's what I did.
Okay. Very nice.
Another common question that we get when people call is, am I too old? Thinking that there's an age limit. We don't have an age limit for PO or police officer or corrections officer. You just got to be at least 21 years old. If you can pass the process, pass testing and everything, we will hire you on. So,
yeah, so
that's
as long,
a pretty common
question. So as long as you meet all the mental acuity and physical restrictions or things that you need to basically perform, there's no age maximum on that.
There's no age max. That's correct.
And we talked about PO and our police officer and maybe civilian. Is CO, is it very corrections officer? Is it very similar in the process in terms of getting hired on, or is there, does it differ a little bit from maybe like the police officer versus a corrections route?
The whole process for police and corrections is exactly the same. So if someone was interested and wasn't exactly sure which route they wanted to go, they can actually apply for both positions, police and corrections recruit, and they just have to take the written exam and the physical fitness test one time, and that counts towards both positions. And they don't have to make a decision on which route they want to go until the end of the background process and they're offered an academy. So it allows them the time to, you know, go do a ride-along patrol, come take a jail tour with me and make a educated decision on what they want to do with their career.
Very cool. Alfredo, what kind of qualities or skills do you think that somebody, if they want to be successful here at LVMPD, what should they possess? What kind of skills and background do you think?
Well, I think a little bit of bearing, maybe like being able to keep your composure. But Metro has a spot for everybody. It's, you know, bring your puzzle piece, we'll make you fit. As long as you can pass all the requirements, make it through our background process, we'll make a home for you. As you mentioned earlier, you know, we have a million different things to do here, so many different opportunities. So, yeah, it's, I mean, I'm part-time coach for Metro, and coaching has nothing to do with police work. But, yeah, just bring what you got, and we'll fit you in.
I'm glad you brought that up. You know, the sheriff, like I said before, he's always talking about how we need to really see the humanity in situations and in people. And I think you're a prime example of that, and your time in Northeast, and you just touched on a little bit, but can we talk about maybe some of the other facets of your job? You know, you wear the badge, but you also are integral in changing lives, kids in the boxing gym and in Northeast. Can you maybe describe what that you do?
For the past about 4 years, been coaching part-time at Center Ring Boxing. There we just take kids in from the community. It is a nonprofit. All the coaches there are volunteers. And, we bring in kids, we coach them, and we've made champions out of that. We've had number one ranked, number three ranked, number five ranked, all, you know, multiple top 10 ranked and national champions out of that little small gym in Northeast. And that's just, you know, with the help from leadership, giving me a few hours to coach at the end of my shift. We go in and put those kids to work, and they come out disciplined and with a lot more confidence than how they started.
How does that make you feel to know that you're making such a difference and impact in these kids' lives?
It's rewarding. It's not just fun. You know, I'm a big fan of boxing. That's just kind of my home. But I don't necessarily do it for anything else, but to just be at my home. And it's very, very rewarding seeing how much these kids change, how much more confident they become, and bringing home a belt. It's pretty nice too.
Yeah, for sure. Dave, how does the department continue to help people either advance in their current position or keep their skills sharp and kind of in a training thing? So I know the department's got a lot of different things. We have the new jetty over on the northeast side of town. How does the department help keep skills sharp and keep training at the very top of the level?
Well, with our just our department, we have every quarter we still have to do our defensive tactics. We have to do our firearms. We have a lot of in-service training that we get. We have our online courses that we can take that we have to take. There's a lot of mandatory things that we have to go through as far as the training, as far as online to keep us sharp, like you said. I've been around for a while in recruiting, like I said, and I've talked to other departments, and I see there's a big difference. And I've also done ride-alongs in different departments. So I've seen the difference that what we have compared to other departments. So this department here, you know, our department here, we do get a lot more training and a lot more mandatory training than other places. So I think that's what keeps our officers sharp.
Yeah, and this is the fight capital of the world. So not only are we, you know, facing a community who's actually pretty proficient in fighting, but the people down at the jetty, those guys are very, very well trained. You know, they've earned their stripes on their belts, and they have a lot of fighting experience. And so it's pretty nice being able to train with such high level athletes that we have on our department.
Right. And Las Vegas is such a melting pot too, of different cultures. And you said different backgrounds and people that have different things that they like. Fighting is obviously one of them with the Las Vegas Strip here. Jimison, I want to ask you, can you give some examples of how the department really engages with the community? I know you've been to several events and you're constantly talking to people, but some examples that you've seen that this department really does well in trying to foster, build that relationship, that authentic relationship through community engagement.
Oh, that's a good question there, Joe. Since I'm on the correction side, I do have experience on the patrol side, but Officer Marquez has experience in the community-oriented policing section, so I'm going to let him talk on that part. But as far as the jail goes, there's still a lot of community outreach things that happen. Like, a lot of people, you know, think they're locked away in jail and people forget about them, but they're still members of the community. So they do a lot of great things between the jail and community partners. Recently they had an event where a bunch of partners came out, people from the DMV, the health district, job resources, different classes, things like that, to bring it to the inmates who are getting ready to be released from custody. The goal is to try to make sure we reduce the recidivism in the jail. We want to see people go back into the community and be successful and be part of the community that way. We have a whole program section over at the jail that does great things, getting these resources and making people in custody still part of the community. But like I said, Officer Marquez can speak greatly on the patrol side of how that works.
Yeah. Alfredo, talk to us about the COP section for people who don't know what it is and what they're charged with basically doing.
So COP, community outreach, or community-oriented policing, they do a lot of outreach, just handing out resources, informing the people of your community. So I just strongly encourage, follow on social media your area command. Find your area command, reach out to them, start showing up to these events. Everything there is all free and so informative, whether it's resources, if you need help regarding a community issue, something that just keeps happening in your neighborhood. We inform people on what we're doing as a police department. And any question that pops up, we've had like multiple people come up and say, hey, how come this random police camera just showed up in my neighborhood? Well, you know, let's talk about ShotSpotter, or, this and this case happened, or if there's a shooting in your neighborhood, best believe COP is going to be out there knocking on your door asking you, hey, are you okay? Did you see anything? Do you need anything? And that's not to get you to talk, because we're not the detectives. We just genuinely want to know if you need anything or if you've seen anything that's concerning.
Yeah, COP does so much. And I oftentimes work with a lot of the officers in the different area commands. And from you, like you said, trunk or treats when you're handing out trick-or-treat, you know, candy to kids, to back-to-school fairs and handing out backpacks, to community cleanups with, different things that are going on in blighted areas. So it really is multifaceted. You're wearing a lot of hats as well with that assignment. So, guys, as kind of time winds down here, I just want to ask you, just on a personal level, your involvement with law enforcement, how did you get into it, and kind of where you got to where you are kind of today, if you don't mind. So, Alfredo, if you don't mind, kind of how did you get into law enforcement?
I had an interesting little story, I guess. When I was younger, I did have my run-ins with the law, and I spoke to one of my teachers about it. My teacher, he asked me what I want to do in my future and how I'm going to get there. I said, I want to be a chef. He's like, I don't see it. I don't see it for you. I think you need the military. So he lined me up with a recruiter, went to the recruiter. Later on, I touched base with him again, and he said, hey, I think maybe the police route would be good for you. I already had that on the back of my mind. I had good interactions. Even though I was in trouble, the police here, you know, treated me right. And, it was an idea I already had in the back of my mind. So I went for it, and here I am 9 years later.
Would you change anything?
Not at all.
Dave, what about you?
So before I got on the department, I was a cable installer, installing cable in people's homes. And just one time I was having a conversation with a customer, and that was, he said, "Hey, you seem like a cool guy. You ever think about being a police officer?" And I said, no. But at work, while I was a cable installer, one time I got injured. I was at home thinking if I can do, if I still wanted to do cable for the rest of my life. It's not something I wanted to do forever. And, you know, just thinking about it later on, I just went through the process. I decided, hey, let me just look at being a police officer. I was 27 years old when I applied. That was the first time I ever thought about being a police officer. So from that point, it was a great decision to me now that I'm looking at it. Back then, it was, you know, I really never thought about being a police officer. And if this is, you know, that's why I actually really like recruiting. Somebody just asked me that question one day. Hey, do you want to be a police officer? Or have you ever thought about being a police officer? And it at that time was no. Yeah. But I got the help from that employee. His name was Eugene Dixon. He was actually a corrections officer for our department. That one question actually is why I got on the department. So
that's incredible.
Yeah.
Wow. Jimson, what about you?
So I came to the department in my early 20s. Like I said, I was going to UNLV. I was ready to go to the business world studying business. I was working full-time on the strip in customer service, and I was actually working part-time at 7-Eleven, rolling hot dogs, eating hot dogs, drinking Slurpees, all that stuff. And like I said, I was looking for a way to finish paying my way through school. Yeah. I didn't have anything against law enforcement, but it just wasn't what I was thinking about. So I applied to be a police officer, but they told me they weren't hiring for police. And a recruiter mentioned corrections. And I said, absolutely no way. I don't want to work in a prison. And they said, no, it's not a prison. It's a county jail. It's, you know, much different. It's more organized. And I was like, I don't know about that. And once he said it, the pay and the benefits was the same, I was like, all right, sign me up. So I became a corrections officer. And once I got on, I never looked back. I mean, the benefits we get from being on the department, I just love talking to people. You know, like I said, like inmates are part of the community too. So whether it's talking to people out on the streets, coworkers or the inmates, you know, it's just nice to get to talk to so many different people, different stages in their life. Some people it's on their worst day and maybe you can make them smile, make that day a little bit better. But yeah, it's been great, and I want to change it.
I want to ask really quick. You brought up benefits, and I think that's a really important point to make because, Dave, you came from the private sector installing cable. You worked in the private sector, Jimison, on the Strip and 7-Eleven. Those were certainly private sector jobs. The difference, because I also came from the private sector. I was a reporter at Channel 13, so I know the private sector pretty well. The benefits versus public versus the private sector. Dave, maybe you can talk a little bit about what the difference is. Like, so if you worked in the private sector, do you get a pension? Did you get all of the different things that we get here at the police department?
No. One, I wasn't making enough for our 401k when I was a cable installer,
right,
to put away. So that's the great thing about our department. We have a great pension plan. So that's the great thing about it. So another thing is for our medical, dental, and vision benefits, employee doesn't have to pay for it. If you do have dependents, yes, you got to pay extra for them, but for us, it's going to be free.
Yeah.
No, I think there's one important benefit we're leaving out here.
What's that?
It's the vacation. Coming from working on the strip, I had to work several years to get to the point of like a week of paid vacation. At least on the commission side here, I know starting out your first year, you get 3 weeks of paid vacation, which is great. And on top of it, the ability to elect, instead of taking like pay for holidays, you can take like additional vacation time. So it allows you to take more time off a year, which sometimes law enforcement can be stressful. I mean, not all the time, but there's times it can be stressful. And having that extra time off to unwind, spend time with family, travel, it really makes a difference on the qualities of life.
Absolutely, and I'm glad you brought that up because in the private sector, I worked for many years in the private sector, and the most that I got, because I bounced around from different places, so you basically your clock starts back at zero with your time served, but maybe 10 days, I get 10 paid days off per year, and here it's 3 weeks, so it's really incredible. What we get to enjoy here versus the private sector. So, guys, I think that's pretty much it. I appreciate your time and appearing on the podcast. We appreciate it. And we'll talk to you guys soon, okay?
Thanks, Joe.
Thanks. Thanks.
What a great conversation with those guys. They are so much fun. You get to hang out with them a lot and see what they're like in real life. And they're truly an asset to this department for sure. I learned a lot about the process. I hope you did too while listening. Now, if you know someone or yourself, even if you're interested in joining the department, you can send them this podcast. You can also visit us at protectthecity.com. You can also email us if you have any questions at recruitment@lvmpd.com. We also have the phone number, which is 702-828-5787. You can also find all that information in the description in this podcast and actually click on it and go right there. Stay tuned for more interesting episodes of The Badge and Beyond Inside the World of LVMPD. We appreciate your time. Thank you for listening.